Turn to James 3. James chapter 3. Glory. In verse 13, James 3 and verse 13. And you see the things that are going on, you wonder, what the heck? What's going on? I mean, in reality of how can mankind still be that blind? How can mankind be that ignorant in the arena of the things that are what is good and evil? I mean, most people don't even, there's so many people don't even know what evil is. They look at everything as, they don't even acknowledge evil. And you know, if you read the word evil in the opposite way, it means life. So you're going to either follow evil or follow the opposite way, which means live, life. In verse 13, would you read it with me? It says, who is wise and understanding among you? Now, that is powerful. Who's wise and understanding? In other words, who has wisdom and understanding? Who's wise? Let him show by good conduct that his works are done in the meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and self-seeking in your hearts, do not boast and lie against the truth. This wisdom does not descend from above, but is earthly, sensual, and demonic. So again, he's expressing that there is a wisdom that is in this earth that he calls demonic. Does everybody get this? There is a wisdom that you and I have been brought up in, that we have gone to school and we have learned and been taught, but the influence of it is demonic because what its purpose is to keep me and you from the wisdom of God. Amen. Remember, the ruler of this earth is Satan. He is behind all education, all training. Look, you can have the wisdom of the world and build beautiful big things. You can have the wisdom of the world and make a lot of money. But none of that gets you home. There is a wisdom that is from above that is totally different from the wisdom of this world. It is different. That's why he says, who is wise and understanding among you? He said, this wisdom does not descend from above, but is earthly, sensual, and demonic. For where envy and self-seeking. So he's telling you that this wisdom is self-seeking wisdom. Where there is envy and self-seeking exist, confusion and every evil thing are there. That's what this wisdom produces. It's self-seeking. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure. It's pure. Then it's peaceable. It's gentle. It's willing to yield. It's full of mercy and good fruits. It's without partiality and without hypocrisy. Now, the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. In other words, he's saying there is a fruit of this wisdom which is called righteousness. And it brings a peace. So, he said, who is wise? Who has wisdom? Who is understanding? Remember, wisdom, the wisdom of God, does two things. It tells you what to do and what to choose. I'm going to say it again. It tells you what to do and what to choose. The understanding from above, it interprets all the things of God. And it tells you how to do it. Has everybody got it? Why? Because it's interpreting, it's understanding. It brings understanding. This understanding, it interprets what God is saying to how to do it. So the wisdom of God tells you what to do or what to choose. And then the understanding from God tells you how to do it. Does everybody understand it? According to godly principles and precepts, not according to man's. When these two when there is wisdom and there's understanding from God, this brings what we call discernment. Discernment. In other words, discernment is able to see what God sees. Oh, grab hold of this. What is it? Able to see what God sees. So in everything you and I are doing, if we're not getting the wisdom from above and the understanding from above, we are not seeing what God sees, and we are missing it. In other words, the wisdom of this world brings blindness to the wisdom of God. Oh, snap. There was a fall, and that's the name of the teaching, Fall of Wisdom. There was a fall of godly wisdom that resulted in the garden in exchange for demonic wisdom. Now, the demonic wisdom, earthly or what we call central wisdom, is continued on in the existence of mankind after the fall of Adam and Eve. It's been influenced ever since then. There was an exchange made in Genesis 3. Let's go there for a second. The devil comes to what? Steal, kill, and destroy. But there was a fall of wisdom in Genesis 3, in verse 1. Let's speak it. The serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, "Has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden?" And the woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it, lest you die." Then the serpent said to the woman, "You shall not surely die. For God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree desirable to what? Make one wise. That was that demonic wisdom. She was being lied to. This wisdom is deceptive. She took of its fruit and ate, and she also gave to her husband with her, and he ate. It says something. Then the eyes of both of them were what? Open. Well, they were actually both closed. But they were open to the wisdom, demonic wisdom, in the realm of carnality, which God did not want. He wanted to train Adam and Eve in the garden so that they would maintain and get their identity with wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. Then the eyes of both of them were open, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves coverings. Again, she saw that it would make one want somebody wise. Well, they were already made in the image and likeness of God. So what did he do? He lied to them, saying, you know what? Well, man, if you partake of this, I'm going to give you some wisdom. You'll be like God. Go to Ezekiel 28. What happened in the gardens when they partook of this? See, to make one wise, there is no shortcut to maturity. Hello? There is no shortcut to maturity. You will not start on the first step and jump to the 15th. God don't allow that. There was a process of maturity. Well, what they were looking, he was convincing that, the serpent was convincing Eve that there was a shortcut. The result was a loss. The main result of everything here was a loss of sight. Can you imagine walking and talking with God every day and seeing the serpent, seeing the angels, and all of a sudden, boom, everything was blinded to you. What a tremendous loss. The exchange. The result was a loss of true sight in the exchange for demonic wisdom, which of influence and all pertaining to a temporary realm. All of this wisdom that was pertaining to a temporary realm. And Ezekiel 28 and verse 12. Is everybody there? Let's speak it. Son of man, take up a lamentation for the king of Tyre and say to him, thus says the Lord God, you were the seal of perfection. Now, we know he's talking about Lucifer. Amen? You were the seal of perfection, full of what? Full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. You were in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was your covering, the sardius, topaz, diamond, braille, onyx, jasper, sapphire, turquoise, and emerald with gold. The workmanship of your timbrels and pipes was prepared for you on the day you were created. You were the anointed cherub who covers. He covered what? The universe with praise and worship. I established you. You were on the holy mountain of God, which was the earth. You walked back and forth in the midst of the fiery stones. In other words, he was there when God created. You were perfect in your ways from the day you were created till what? Iniquity was found in you. Until what? Iniquity was found in you. Now, I want you to go back to verse 1. Yeah. Are you ready? And the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, say to the prince of Tyre, thus says the Lord God, because your heart is lifted up, and you say, I am a God. Now, I want you to understand something about the earthly wisdom, the demonic wisdom. Not only does it promote blindness, but self, promote self, it puts a person into, I am a God, what he calls a prideful, godly heart. I am a God. I sit in the seats of gods, in the midst of the seas. Yet you are a man and not a God, though you set your heart as the heart of a God. Behold, you are wiser than Daniel. There is no secret that can he hidden from you. With your wisdom and understanding, you gained riches for yourself and gathered gold and silver into your treasures. By your great wisdom in trade, you have increased your riches, and your heart is lifted up because of your riches. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, because you have set your heart as a heart of a God, behold, therefore, I will bring strangers against you, the most terrible of the nations, and they shall draw their swords against the beauty of your wisdom and defile your splendor. They shall throw you down into the pit, and you shall die the death of the slain in the midst of the sea. So understand this. Grab hold of it, because this is so powerful. This is self-seeking. This wisdom that is from demonic, that came from Lucifer, who was beautiful, was full of wisdom. When he rebelled against God, his wisdom of light became wisdom of darkness. And that's what rules the earth. You know, you wonder why, what's going on? Well, the Lord said that they live under what we call fallen wisdom, demonic wisdom. Why? Because they cannot see. They are blinded. They are self-seeking. They have a heart set that they are God. In other words, when he says a heart set as a God, he said, in other words, they have no reverence to him. They do anything they want without acknowledging him. That gives them a heart set towards a God. Is everybody okay? Self-seeking heart of a God. This heart attitude is provoked by demonic influence. Taking captive, gullible individuals believing they know better than God. and have made themselves gods, promoting works of the flesh, passing these traditional doctrines of demonic wisdom, causing blindness, selfishness, divisions, hatred, murder, and great deceptions, and they will die, never seeing the truth. Lucifer turned his wisdom and splendor into darkness, calling good evil and evil good, promoting lies in every evil way, not exposing it. Never trying to keep it hidden all the time. In 1 Kings chapter 3, Did you ever talk to people that are have the wisdom of the world, very intellect? They can talk their way through all kinds of stuff, man. They can, and they don't know nothing. They're so smart, they're stupid. They have to hold on to that. That's what gives them hope, but it's false hope. This wisdom from the world brings false hope, brings blindness, separation from God. In 1 Kings chapter 3 and verse 4. Is everybody there? Okay. This is about King Solomon. Now the king went to Gibeon to sacrifice there, for that was the great high place. Solomon offered 1,000 burnt offerings on that altar. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night, and God said, "Ask." Why did he say yes? In other words, he was willing to give him whatever he wanted. Why? Because he was doing the things that were right before him. You know, there's many people that are asking for God when they're not doing the right things. He said, "Ask, what shall I give you?" And Solomon said, "You have shown great mercy to your servant David, my father, because he walked before you in truth, in righteousness, and in uprightness of heart with you. You have continued this great kindness for him, and you have given him a son to sit on his throne as it is this day. Now, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king instead of my father David. But I am a what? I am a what? I am a what? I am a little child." Let me tell you, the moment you try to connect with God as not being a child, you are disconnected. Does everybody get it? He said, "Come to me like a what? Child." Anything other than that is prideful. He said, "I am a child. I do not know how to go out or to come in." Man, that's being honest with God, isn't it? You know, "Lord, I don't know. I really need your help." Why? He's looking for a child. Is dependent. It's all trusting. It's quick to forgive, too. "And your servant is in the midst of your people whom you have chosen, a great people, too numerous to be numbered or counted. Therefore, give your servant an understanding heart to judge your people, that I may discern between good and evil. For who is able to judge the great people of yours?" Now that is powerful. What does it say? I'm a child. That's where you and I got to maintain a childlike dependence on the Lord. See, so many people have a entitlement attitude. That's what the wisdom of this world gives people, an entitlement attitude. It's an entitlement of the heart as a god. It's demonic wisdom. But here, Solomon came before the Lord and an attitude as a child, saying, "You know what? I can't do this." But we know that it didn't last real long. In chapter 11, see, the enemy wants to come and steal. Amen? He came. Now, remember that Solomon, man, he was given this wisdom. And God said, "Because you didn't ask for riches, you didn't ask for anything else, you asked for wisdom. I'm giving you everything. I'm giving you everything." And he was the most wealthiest man in the world. People from all over the world came to see Solomon and the wisdom that he carried. In 1 Kings chapter 11, in verse 1. Let's speak it. But King Solomon loved many foreign women. Hallelujah. As well as the daughter of Pharaoh. Women of the Moabites, Amorites, Edomites, Sidonianites, Hittites, Slezites. From the nations of whom the Lord had said to the children of Israel, you shall not intermarry with them, nor they with you. Surely they will turn away your hearts after their gods. Solomon clung to these in love. He allowed his emotions to make decisions. And he was actually allowing the wisdom of God to be stolen from him in exchange for demonic wisdom. In verse 3, he had 700 wives. Dear God. Dude didn't sleep, man. Can you imagine? Never mind. Don't even imagine. Man, his door was knocking constantly. Man, he had a honey-dude list that was incredible. Of course, he just passed it on. 700 wives, princesses, and 300 concubines. In other words, other affairs with other women. And his wives turned away his heart. No kidding, you had 700 over one? You're out of there. Many just, never mind. And so it was. When Solomon was old, that his wives turned his heart after other gods, and his heart was not loyal to the Lord, his God, as was the heart of his father David. So Solomon went after Ashtaroth, the goddess of Sidonians, and after Malcham, the abomination of the Ammonites. Solomon did evil in the sight of the Lord and did not fully follow the Lord as did his father David. Then Solomon built a high place for Chemosh, the abomination of Moab, and the hill that is east of Jerusalem, and for Moloch, the abomination of people of Ammon. And he did likewise for all his foreign wives, who burned incense and sacrifices to their gods. So the Lord became angry with Solomon, because his heart had turned away from the Lord God of Israel, who had appeared to him twice, and had commanded him concerning this thing, that he should not go after other gods. But he did not keep what the Lord had commanded. Therefore the Lord said to Solomon, because you have done this, and have not kept my covenant and my statutes which I commanded you, I shall surely tear the kingdom away from you and give it to your servant. Wow. So you know you can't fulfill the kingdom of God. I want you to know that you may start off right, but you better be careful on how you end up. The enemy is out to steal, kill, and destroy. He's out to exchange anything he can with you every single moment, every single day. And look it, if you don't start the day in prayer, God knows. You may think you're getting blessed, but you have no idea that you're going to lose it all. Because that's not wisdom from above. Wisdom from beneath has an entitlement attitude. It has a self-seeking attitude. And it brings blindness. Because you're saying to God, I don't need to do this because you know my heart. But he's saying you have a heart of a God and it's prideful. And unless you're willing to seek me, everything you earn, you'll earn on your own. And it won't be my blessing. And eventually, you'll lose it all. Many of us have been in those circumstances already. We started off right, mostly because we got in trouble. Something occurred. We hit the reality wall, and we said, oh, Lord, whatever it is, I'll do. I'll do. Well, maybe later. I'll do later. And then there's drift, disconnect. Because they're not asking for the wisdom from above. They're not seeking the wisdom of God. They started off being zealous and on fire. And believe me, the enemy wants to quench your fire. He wants to begin to turn things around and exchange things so that you're not zealous for the house of God anymore, so that you grumble and complain. Man, once he hears you grumble and complain, he throws that rod with more bait on the end, and then people got hooks hanging off their mouths. I've actually seen that. And it's just a matter of time where he pulls the bait. Solomon's wisdom did not keep him from being misled and taken captive to exchange godly wisdom for demonic wisdom, losing sight of his mission, making wrong choices, losing understanding of interpretation, and in losing direction. Here was another fall of wisdom not carried out and not carried on. Again, the first fall was in the garden. And God had given people wisdom, but then they allowed the enemy to come and steal it. In Psalm 111, in verse 10, Psalm 111 and verse 10, let's speak it, please. Is everybody there? The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Again, the demonic wisdom brings no fear of God. There's no fear. There's no acknowledgement. Amen? The fear of the Lord is the beginning of God's wisdom. And a good understanding of all those who do his commandments, his praise endures forever. So there's a good understanding. Why? Because they're interpreting what God is asking him what? How to do it. Remember, wisdom tells you what to do. Understanding tells you how to do it. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of godly wisdom and a good understanding. So we can see what God sees and choose what he chooses and speak what he wants us to speak. There's a difference. When you are not seeing what God is seeing in everything that you're doing, there's demonic influence. Every choice, every decision you make, everything you're doing, you want to see it the way God sees it. So you know the end result. Lord, should I make this decision? Well, he's going to say, well, ask me for wisdom. I'll give you understanding. I'll give you discernment. Why? So you can see it all the way through. Lord, I need your wisdom on this. Even when we're doing counsel, I ask for the Holy Spirit to come. We ask for wisdom. What are we asking for? Wisdom. Why? So we can see. Wisdom. So what? We can see what God wants us to see, so we can see exactly what God is seeing. What is God seeing in this? Too many people don't even ask that question. Lord, what are you seeing in this? They're too busy relying on their own wisdom, which is actually demonic, instead of the wisdom from God, which is able to cause you to see. So that we can see what he sees and choose what he chooses and speak the way he wants us to speak. Proverbs 3. It's a mess. You got all these think tanks. They're actually stupid tanks. That's all they're trying to do. And let me tell you, the devil's walking around in these tanks. Yeah, let's give him wisdom. And they come out with, yes, let's contact all these think tanks and see what we're going to do. Oh, they have such great wisdom. They're creating wars and killing one another. I mean, come on, let's think about this. The world is a mess globally. because it's been ruled by Satan's wisdom, which is great deception. In Proverbs 3, did I say 3? Good. In verse something, 13. Proverbs 3:13. Happy is the man who what? Woohoo! Happy is the man who finds wisdom and the man who gains understanding. For her proceeds are better than the profits of silver and her gain than fine gold. She is more precious than rubies, and all the things you may desire cannot compare with her. Length of days is in her right hand, in her left hand riches and honor. Her ways are ways of pleasantness, and all her paths are peace. She is a tree of life to those who take hold of her, and happy are all who retain her. This is phenomenal. Wisdom, again, is what to do and what to choose. Understanding is how to do it and interpretation. Knowledge is the substance that is used to mold and build by wisdom and understanding. Knowledge is the substance. Which is used to mold and build by wisdom and understanding. Proverbs 11. Proverbs 11, in verse 14, where there is what? No counsel. Where there is no counsel. Now this is the, understand that this counsel means godly wisdom. Where there's no godly wisdom or understanding. Where there's no counsel, the people fall. But in a multitude of counselors or consistent counseling, there is what? Safety. No counsel, many fall. Sometimes multitude of counseling is needed for safety. Why? Because it brings choices, direction. It brings counsel, correction, and direction, doesn't it? Which brings safety. And the counsel usually brings us back under the wisdom and understanding from above. Amen? Exodus 31. But you reject counsel, shame on you. Exodus 31. Hallelujah. Exodus 31 and verse 1. Is everybody there? Let's speak it. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, see, I have called by name Bezaleel, the son of Uri, the son of Ur, the tribe of Judah. And I have filled him with the what? Spirit of God. In other words, the Holy Spirit. In what? Wisdom and in understanding and in knowledge and in all manner of workmanship. To what? Design artistic works for the work in gold and in silver and bronze, in cutting jewels for setting, in carving wood, and to work in all the manner of workmanship. For what? What are they doing? Building the house of God. Does everybody got it? So again, this is so powerful because we see here that God, by the Holy Spirit, imparted wisdom with understanding and knowledge that they may see what God sees. Why? He wanted them to build. He didn't send them pictures for them to follow. He imparted them, by the Spirit of the living God, the wisdom and understanding and knowledge that they may see what he sees so they could build it according to way God wanted it done. I mean, that's snapping powerful. Now remember, because God wanted them to see what he wants them to see. So demonic wisdom sees what the devil wants you to see. Self seeking, blinding people from what is the truth. Colossians 1. You know, one of the things I've realized is that God checks us out, wanting to know if we're going to use the wisdom and understanding. Something will occur that all of a sudden there will be a sudden change or shift or something happens in your life. You could be working somewhere and all of a sudden, Lord, something happens and you get moved. Or something happens in your life or you get sick or whatever. And he's wanting to know whether you're still standing. If you start your grumbling and complaining, he said, man, wrong wisdom. Wrong wisdom. He's always trying to bring us to that place. Where, why? Because, see, instead of grumbling and complaining, grab hold of the Lord. Man, I know he's got something good for me. I know there's a purpose. Who knows? Maybe he moved me from here because this is going to end or there was some damage or whatever. Or maybe he just moved me or did something in my life to check me out. He wanted to know if I could still stand. I find that all the time. Even when we're sick, when whatever's going on, God's always checking. Are you going to still connect? Are you going to still seek me? Are you going to still call on my name? Are you going to still trust me? Are you going to still ask for more wisdom and understanding? Or are you going to stop? What about when God says no? Or what about when he doesn't answer? Or something doesn't go your way? Oh, and people, you know what? People get offended with God when they don't get what they want. Is that incredible? How can you get offended with God? Well, he's not giving me what I want. Well, you probably don't stink and deserve it. It's real simple. Why? Because you haven't earned his trust. If you'd pass more of those tests, you might get what you're asking for. But he ain't going to give you something you ain't passed tests on. Everything comes with a test. Everybody say it. Everything comes with a test. If I'm not faithful with the test, I don't get it. And most of the time, they don't get it anyway. Glory. Lord, why are you doing this? Why don't you ask for more wisdom and get understanding? Colossians chapter 1 and verse 9. Remember, this is not an entitlement thing. Just because you got saved, filled with the Holy Ghost, doesn't mean you get everything. Everything still is a process of training, reigning, and earning, and testing. Remember, Solomon was filled with the Spirit of God, wisdom. Amen? What happened to him? He ended up marrying 700 women or whatever it was. That wasn't very wisdom at all. That had been plumb stupid. He should have bought a Doberman Retriever. I mean, whatever it is. Golden Retriever, yeah. Praise God. Some of you will get that someday. Colossians 1, verse 9. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's speak it together. For this reason, we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom. In other words, remember, knowledge is what? Substance. What's the substance of his will? In all wisdom in what? Spiritual understanding. That you may walk worthy of the Lord, fully what? Pleasing him. Being fruitful in every good work. Increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might according to his glorious power, for all patience and long suffering with joy, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in the light. He has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of his love, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. Woo-hoo! That's powerful. Filled with substance of his will. In other words, and with all wisdom, what to do with this, with his will. And how to do it. Amen? 1 Corinthians 1 and verse 18. Let's speak it together. Is everybody there? For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this age? Has not God made foolishness the wisdom of this world? Woohoo! For since in the wisdom of God, the world through wisdom did not know God. So the wisdom of this world does not know God. Never, it never will know God. Only the wisdom of God knows God. It pleased God through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. For Jews request a sign and Greeks seek after wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, to the Jews a stumbling block, and to the Greeks foolishness. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For you see your calling, brethren, that not many wise according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God has chosen the foolish things of the world to put to shame the wise. Isn't that something? See, we're no longer under the wisdom of the world. We're under the wisdom of God. So we should be able to see what God wants us to see and see things through. Every decision you make, you know whether God's approving it or disapproving it. If you don't, you're under Satan's control. But God has chosen the foolish things of the world to put to shame the wise, and God has chosen the weak things of the world to put to shame the things which are mighty. And the base things of the world and the things which are despised, God has chosen, and the things which are not, to bring to nothing the things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. But of him you are in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God, the righteousness and sanctification and redemption, that as it is written, he who glories, let him glory in the Lord. Praise be to God. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Verse 6. Let's speak it. However, we speak wisdom among those who are what? Mature. Yet not the wisdom of this age, nor the rulers of this age, who are coming to nothing. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, the hidden wisdom which God had ordained before the ages for our glory, for which none of the rulers of this age knew, for had they known, they would have not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love him. But God has revealed them to us through his Spirit, for the Spirit searches all things, yes, the deep things of God. For what man knows the things except for the Spirit of the man which is in him? Even so, no one knows the things of God except for the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the Spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, that we might know the things that have been freely given to us by God. These things we speak not in words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Spirit teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. But the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, nor can he know them because they are spiritually discerned. But he who is spiritual judges all things, yet he himself is rightly judged by no one. For who has known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ with wisdom, knowledge, understanding, and discernment. And I'm going to close at Ephesians 5. It is wisdom. This wisdom of the world does not know God. There will come a fall to this wisdom, though. There was a fall of the wisdom. Actually, it was stolen. Amen? Godly wisdom was stolen. It was reactivated, imparted by the Holy Spirit. But the wisdom of this world is also, its final is going to be fallen also. So there was a fallen wisdom from the beginning, and there's going to be a fallen wisdom. And it's the fallen wisdom of this world. God will destroy it all. In Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 8, the fall of the wisdom of this world, and it'll be the rise of the wisdom of God. That's why you see what's going on all over. Because that wisdom of the world is self-seeking. It brings blindness. It brings bondage. Is everybody there? Verse 8, let's speak it. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. For the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness, righteousness, and truth, finding out what is acceptable to the Lord. And have no fellowship with unfruitful works of darkness, but what? Rather expose them. Why? Because they're out to steal, kill, and destroy. For it is shameful even to speak of those things which are done by them in secret. But all things that are exposed are made manifest by the light. For whatever makes manifest is light. Therefore, he says, awake, you who sleep. Arise from the dead, and Christ will give you light. See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are what? They're evil. They're what? Evil. Therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not be drunk with the wine in which this is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another in the what? In the fear of God, because the fear of the Lord is the what? Beginning of wisdom. Again, we are seeing a great fall of wisdom. We're seeing a great fall of wisdom in the body of Christ. People are exchanging the wisdom of God for the wisdom of the world to become wealthy. It's amazing to me. And how blind people are becoming. So they're not really seeing what God is wanting them to see. Or making choices according to what God is seeing. Because they're exchanging that. See, the enemy comes in multiple forms, especially in the area of anxiousness, fear, pride, arrogance, greed. All of these things. He wants you to build your kingdom, not his. That's what the enemy wants to do. He wants you to stop laboring unto the Lord. He doesn't want you to connect with God. He wants you to be enslaved with demonic wisdom, so you're a self-seeking, entitlement individual, never looking to see whether God is approving or disapproving. Leaning on our own understandings instead of God's understanding. And the Lord warns us, lean not on your own understanding. Amen. He warns us all the time. The enemy comes to put people out of position quickly. Man, you watch the news, that's all you hear is demonic wisdom. Democratic parties, Republican parties, bunch of demonic wisdom. That's why the Lord says, seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness, Why? Because when you do that, you will get wisdom, knowledge, and understanding from above. All of these things that are happening, people are falling left and right. But eventually, the wisdom of this world will come down. And you know whose responsibility to bring it down is? Ours. Ours. It's our responsibility to carry the wisdom of God in every place. It's our responsibility to push out and drive out darkness. It's our responsibility. God gave me and you the earth. He gave us the earth. And so easily we allow Satan to interrupt and turn things around, and interrupt in lives. We allow him to make decisions for us instead of allowing God to make the decisions. We are in a crisis time right now. I'm telling you, things are about to happen and explode, and many people will not be ready. They won't know what to do. The word says that people will run to and fro and all over the place trying to find help. But what the enemy does is he loves to create a chaos. When he creates a chaos, he brings a solution. He's got a solution for every chaos in your life. And you're going to either take the one from the enemy or take the one from above. One will lead you in peace, joy, and righteousness, and right standing and upright with God, prosperity from the Lord, and protection with the Lord. The other one will lead you in a life of deception, confusion, an emotional decision up and down all the time in your life. Uncertainties. Always questioning God. Because there's no faith. That wisdom comes and steals faith from mankind. Amen? Again, we are in a powerful, powerful time to be alive. Let us not only be the light, the truth, but let us carry the wisdom of God in multiple places. And let our conduct express God's love, knowing that we are connected with him with wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. Amen? But remember, it comes by staying filled with the Spirit of God. Staying filled. Do whatever you got to do. Stay filled. And make sure you connect every morning. But first, disconnect from the world so you can connect. If you're not a person of prayer, you're a person that can never be trusted. And God knows that. Amen? Praise God. Father, we give you all the glory and honor and praise, and we thank you. We thank you, we thank you, we thank you. Again, we ask for more wisdom and understanding that we may see what you want us to see, that we may choose what you want us to choose, and that we may speak what you want us to speak, so that your name would be glorified and so that your kingdom will penetrate and infiltrate into this realm, bringing down the wisdom of this world, the haughtiness, and the demonic influence, that people may be rescued and raised up as soldiers of the Most High God, rescuing others that have been taken captive in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen. Amen. Be blessed and stay dressed with the glory.